So we stopped last time talking about non-symplectic automorphism and more precisely more purely non-symplectic automorphism. So let's see some example of non-symplectic automorphism or automorphism in general and discuss something about different properties. So the most easy example are the so-called natural automorphisms. How one gets natural automorphism, but anytime that you have SK3 and sigma acting on S an automorphism, symplectic or non-symplectic make no difference, then you get in a natural way an automorphism that I call sigma n acting on Sn. So just think about if you take one n points, just what does a sigma n do? Well, it's sent just to sigma x1, sigma xn. And this automorphism has the property, so recall that Sn can be seen as a resolution of singularity of the symmetric quotient of S by the permutation group, and you have an exceptional divisor that I called A. So this have the property. That sigma of A is equal to E. So recall that, just to recall the notation, we have that H2SnZ can be written as H2SZ plus Z delta, where this delta such that 2 delta is equal to E. This is the exceptional class. And in fact, this property characterizes them. So we have the following proposition together with Boissière and myself in 2010. So take phi an automorphism for the notation. Yes. Yeah, phi an automorphism of Sn. Well, then we have that phi is natural. So then this means that of this kind, if and only if phi of E is equal to E. So just give me a sketch of the proof. So one implication is clear. So we have seen this already. So if it's natural, it has these properties. Let me see, so this direction is more interesting. So we are assuming that the exceptional set is invariant. So this means that the action phi star on H2SnZ is in fact equal to some F identity. So this means F is on this part of the cohomology and the identity on the last part. But then we need the following fact, and moreover, so F is a Hodge isometry because phi is an automorphism. So moreover, by using result of Huybrechts and Buxom, one can write a Kähler class let's say kappa in Ksn, so this is the Kähler cone of Sn, as a sum k0 plus lambda e, where e is real and lambda is negative. So that if I look at the action of phi star on the Kähler class, so I have that phi star of k is equal to, well, f of k0 plus lambda e, because here is the identity. And this must be again, so with k0, so you don't write it here, is a Kähler class coming from the k3 surface. So this fk0 is again a Kähler class. on the K3 surface. And then, so you have this isometry, now you go back to K3 surfaces, because you have an isometry of H2, which is a Hodge isometry and preserve a Keller class, we preserve the Keller cone. So this means then use Torelli for K3 to get, let's say, some psi in out S, such that psi star, the action is equal to F. Okay, but then if you take the natural automorphism induced by psi, and clearly, because of the construction, we have that the action of Cn star, so the action on H2, is the same as phi star. And now use injectivity of the map. The map out x in O H2 Sn, oh sorry, Sn. Sn z is injective by a result of Bouville. So that in fact then our phi must be natural. So the fact that to preserve this exceptional set is really characterized the natural automorphism. And in this way, this is an easy way to produce a lot of automorphism, because take, for example, when I was saying last time, talking about purely non-symmetric automorphism of order between 2 and 19, how do you produce example on Sn, but just take an automorphism of same kind and same order on the K3, give an example here. And we remarked last time there is one case more when you consider the Hilbert scheme, so which is 23.
So the theorem you quoted by Arno that this map is injective always true for every hyperkeller manifold?
No, it's false. Yeah. For generalized Kummer, for example, you have something here, something in the cloud. Okay. No, it's not true. No. Oh, no, it's also for O'Grady. One of the two O'Grady is true and the other one is not true. No. And so let me give also a non-natural example. So these are more difficult to construct in the sense that, say, with Torelli one can construct them, but geometrically this is much more difficult. But the first one was, again, by Arnaud. Non-natural example. Which is the so-called Bouville involution. So the idea is very explicit and very geometric. So take S in P3, a quartic K3 surface, and assume that S not containing a line. So for example, you take a generic quartic, so this is picker number one, so it makes the work. And we look at the following remarks. So take, let's see, Z consisting of two points, P1 of P2, P1 and P2 on S. And then generically, so you take the point generic enough, you have a line going through this that cut into more points, which are Q1 and Q2. So you define a map from S2 from S2, first irrational, sending, let's say, Z, let me call Z prime equal Q1, Q2, any two points, so let's say Z, to Z prime, which is the intersection of the line LP1, P2, so if in this setting, minus the point P1, P2. And then, in fact, he showed in this paper that this is really a bihomeomorphic map. It is an involution. And one can show, so there are different ways to see that, but in view of this proposition, that in fact this involution does not preserve the exceptional set, so this is not natural. It's surely something that is not natural. And maybe some remark about that. So this evolution will play an important role a bit all the time when we study then two ample polarization and in particular involution. So some properties of this involution. Well, first of all, one can compute the invariant lattice. So I call this involution iota b. Is isometric to the lattice 2, so the rank 1 lattice with this quadratic form. And this is z h minus delta. If I denote h the class of a divisor, so h in ns, s, the non-severity group of the quartic, h squared equal to 4, and well, delta square is equal minus 2, coming on is 2. So we have this. Moreover, one can show that this involution is non-symplectic. And finally, so this, in particular, this S2 with coming from the quartic is ample to polarized. So this one can show that this divisor is ample. EHS manifold, EHS of type K3, two manifold. And this, in fact, are the situation I'm going to talk later. So what does it mean to polarize? Just to precise the notation. So to polarize means that there is a primitive embedding. Of 2 in ns sn. So need not to be unique, so the lattices where this is not unique, but for 2 it is the case. And recall that to precise this fact that it's ample 2 polarized, so recall that I was saying this last time, that any time you have a non-symplectic involution, so h2s2z, the invariant lattice is always contained ns. S2, so not only for S2, but for hyperkähler model in general, and the transcendental lattice is then contained the orthogonal complement. Okay, let's go now to ample two polarized EHS manifold, and in particular this of kind F2. So these are somehow the most easy polarizations that one can consider. And we will see two different somehow application, or I will give first some general result on two ample polarized EHS manifold type K3-2, and then what I'm going to do is talking about Morin problem that is related to this kind of manifold, and then automorphism in the last part. I hope to have a little time to do that. So let's say ample two polarization and evolution. So to motivate this study, maybe go back to K3 and let's see what happened there. So you remember when a K3 is ample polarized, so SK3, and assume that S is two ample polarized. So this meaning, I have this primitive embedding at the non-severity group. Then, for example, so this very much study, Sandona. In the 70s, around the 70s, was studying very much a projective model of K3 surfaces, and in this case, S is a double cover of P2 ramified on a sextic. A smooth sextic. And here I have an involution, which is a covering involution, which has the following properties. So first we know that on S we have an ample divisor D such that d squared is equal to 2. And in fact, it is the generator of is d, generically. And so it is left invariant by iota. So iota is non-symplectic involution. So acts as minus 1 on the period. And what else? So let's say about the action on the H2. So the action of iota star acts on H2SZ. Let's see as a reflection. Say in this way, reflection. Even if it's not maybe precise sense of the terminology, in the following sense that E star of D is equal to D and E star of V is equal to minus V for any V in D perp. And what we want to understand now is what happened for S2. What can we say about S2 and its deformation? So question. S2 and deformation. So the question is, can we expect somehow similar result? Well, I will start with two theorem propositions that in fact generalize them the situation. So following theorem. So we have two theorems. That are quite useful. So the first is theorem 1. Take x deformation of S2 and assume that NSX contains D, an ample class with D squared equal to 2. Then X carries admit a non-symplectic involution and H2X Z iota is equal to generated by this divisor D. So I do prove that. One uses, in fact, Torelli. Just let me give a sketch of the proof. Just idea. So use Torelli for S2. And in fact, when one uses Torelli, when one study S2, Torelli theorem is particularly simple because it's exactly the same as for K3 surfaces. So we define the involution in the following way. First, we define on the lattice, so phi. In the following way, v associate d times v minus v. D times v, v minus v. So one check easily that this is an isometry. D minus V. So this is an isometry, one can check it easily, and has many other good properties to become an automorphism of X. So phi is isometry. Moreover, since omega X belongs to delta perp, we have that phi of omega X is equal to minus omega X. But in any case, the line 2,0 is preserved, so that phi is odd. And moreover, by construction, phi of d is equal to d, so phi preserves an ample class. on import class, and so preserve the Keller cone. So that we have that we can apply Markman-Verbitsky Torelli theorem. To say that there is f in outer x such that f star is equal to phi. And to conclude that f star is an involution, again we use the fact that the map, as I wrote there, is injective. And since phi star square is equal to phi square equal to identity plus injectivity out x of h2x is injective, this tells us that f is an involution. And by construction has the right properties that I said in the theorem. Let me show also the converse of this theorem, that is also easy to prove. So having this ample class is the same as having the evolution. And the converse. So it tells us that if we have the involution, then we have this ample class. So theorem 2. We will use this two theorem later when we'll talk about the automorphism of S2. So the converse, we have always x of tape S2, iota acting on x, non-symplectically. And we assume also that the rank of the invariant lattice is equal to 1. So we need this hypothesis for the ampleness. Then we know that, put a star here, I2 we can show x z, iota star is zd, d square equal to 2, ample. Again, the idea of this, just sketch of the proof, is very easy. But, well, we know that x is projective because we have this non-symplectic involution. So we have L on X, ample line bundle. And then taking L plus iota star L, we get an invariant ample line bundle. Or let's say maybe belongs to this space. That is one-dimensional, so this means that any divisor here, so this is an invariant ample cone, so it's contained here, so any class here is invariant, and this is equal to 2 by using classification of non-symplectic involution. On x plus 2, that we did some year ago with several collaborators. Well, always one uses lattice properties, so in particular one knows that this must be 2 elementary, and so if it is rank 1 and 2 elementary, you know it must be necessarily 2. So that we have the statement. And this, in fact, are exactly the generalization of the result one has for K3 surfaces. So now one has given this characterization. One can then construct a moduli space of ample two-polarized EHS. So, moduli space just recall very briefly what I mean here. So, by using results of Hulek, Gritsenko and Sankaran, who was studying the moduli spaces of EHS manifold or type K3N, one can construct a moduli space, let's call M2, of ample two polarized EHS manifold of type K32. So the first thing one has to do is to fix an embedding of 2 in the lattice of the K32 manifold. But well, I don't have to do that because so remark that in this case one can use lattice theory, result of Nicooling. There is a unique embedding, primitive embedding, of 2 in the lattice, what I call L, which is the lattice of the K32 time manifold, which is 3 copy of U plus E8 minus 1 square plus minus 2. This not need to be always the case, so it is the case for K3 when you take always a rank 1 lattice, but not here. For example, if you remember the Fano variety of lines, this is 6 polarized. But in fact, there are 2 different embeddings of 6 in this lattice and give you 2 different families. One is the final variety of lines of a cubic four-fold, and the other one, one does not know what is geometrically. So there is another family. But here we don't have the problem, so we have only 1 primitive embedding. And it's interesting where the period lives. In this case, so for an x here inside, live as for K3 in the orthogonal complement of 2, tensorized by C, so this set, such that omega squared to 0, omega bigger than 0. So as for the Bovill-Bogomolov Fujiki form, and this is 20 dimensional. So again, so we have 23, 22, it's a quadric and an open analytic subset here. It's 20 dimensional, and we have an isomorphism between this M2 and, so I call this period domain omega 2, and this omega 2 where I have to do some remarks. So I have to take away some hyperplanes that I call delta per and divide by some group to mod out isomorphism classes. And what is this? Well, here is exactly where the polarization is no more ample, like for K3. So I will not say exactly what is delta, because delta are what are called MBM classes. So not don't go into the definition now because I don't need that, but it's played the same role as minus 2 curves for EHS manifold. So the period lives in fact here. And what one has to say is that one can do a very similar picture in many cases, but this not need to be reducible all the time. But in this case, this is reducible. And I think it's a real maybe for Kulegritzenko Sankaran of Olivier and Emanuele Macri, I don't know. In any case, this space is irreducible so that we have this, this isomorphism. And we can describe it this like that. And thanks to other 2 theorems, this is also the moduli space, thanks to result of Dolgachev, Kondo, Juma. In the last year that study moduli space of EHS with automorphism, this is also moduli space of EHS of type K32 with non-symplectic involution with invariant lattice lattice 2. So this follows somehow from our 2 theorem and also from the remark that the action of this involution can be given in a unique way on the lattice. So anytime you construct this moduli space, for example, also for automorphism, one first thing one has to fix is the action on the lattice. So a priori, there is no reason to have only 1 action possible, but it's possible in this case. And the generic element in this space are the so-called double epivalent sextic, what I'm going to talk about. So, remark, a result of O'Grady, he showed that the generic element in ML2 in M2 are, let's say, double EPW sextet. And PVW sextet can be seen as a higher dimensional generalization of K3 that are double planes. It's no more here. So when X is double cover a K3, or call it S, double cover of P2, which ramifies on some sextet. And well, a very similar situation happened here. And this allowed me to do the transition now to the Morin double EPV sextet and the Morin problem. Actually, this is a bit a digression from automorphism. So, well, double EPV sextet, we will see, comes with a natural involution. So there is always some involution hidden some way. But this is more a property, so this connection with Morin problem is more about this EHS manifold that have very nice properties, and this classical problem of Morin that is of 1930. Okay, let me recall the definition of double EPV sextet. So the definition is quite technical. So we'll not do all the details, but at least give you an idea. So we will fix a vector space, so the construction. So let me just, for simplicity here, work with a vector space complex of dimension 6, and I take really C6. But you can do the construction on any complex vector space of dimension 6. So we fix first an isomorphism. Between lambda 6, C6 and C, which is the volume. And by taking the volume, one gets a symplectic form. Going from lambda 3, C6, times lambda 3, C6, to C, that a couple U and V associate the volume of U wedge. So I have a symplectic form, and then I consider Lagrangian subspaces. So this is, as you, 20 dimensional. So let me consider now Lagrangian subspaces. So take A in lambda 3, C6 Lagrangian. So dimension of A is equal 10, and we have that volume U wedge V is equal 0 for any U V in A, so maximal dimension 10. And consider the following spaces. If v is in C6, consider f of v, which is the set of v wedge, so v is fixed, v wedge alpha, such that alpha is a lambda 3, lambda 2, C6, which is actually equal to v, because of course if alpha contains v is equal to v, this is 0, so we have wedge lambda 2 C6 modulo v. And this is Lagrangian 10-dimensional. This is easy, it's clear to the definition. So. And these are in fact the fiber of a bundle, a vector bundle of rank 10. So the f of v are the fiber of a sheaf, better, let's say f, which is OP5 minus 1, so I on P5, tensor product with lambda 2q. Well, this is a tautological bundle. With fiber, let's say this C6 modulo V. And one can compute the Chern class, the first Chern class of F. It's an explicit computation. One can compute that the first Chern class of F is minus 6H, so the 6 is already very good for us. And H is a hyperplane section in P5. Okay, now we need a variety to find a variety. And for this, so let me take the inclusion of F and then projection. So we consider the inclusion of F in lambda 3, 6, 6 tensor of P5, and then I do the projection on lambda T3, C6, modulo A, of P5. And then let's call this map, composition of projection and inclusion, lambda A is equal to P cos iota. And so I have a map of vector bundle. So on vector bundles, I call this lambda A from F to this quotient. This is nothing else than a dual, of course. And now I'm going to study, so to define this hypersurface, one study where this the rank of this map drops. So the V where this map has not maximal rank. So these are two of, both have rank 10, and I'm looking for the V where this is not maximal rank. And we can do then give the definition of EPV sextic. So maybe one remark, one can compute that, again by using properties of bundle, tensor product, etc., showing that the determinant of lambda A, because it's the object, is in fact a global section of P5 or P5 or 6. It's a computation that uses this fact. And we give the definition of double EPV sextic. Sorry, EPV sextic first and then double EPV sextic after that. So definition. EPV sextic. So YA equal to the zero set of that lambda A. And assume also that, so let's say this. If YA is not P5, So you have badly chosen your A. There are cases where this is all P5. For example, if you take a double F, you know, A of this kind, of the kind FV, then you get all P5. So one has to exclude this case. It is a hypersurface, which is singular, in fact, in P5 of degree 6. And it's called EPB sexy. So let me say where does this name come from. So EPW is Eisenbahn-Popescu-Walter sextic. That in some paper of, remember the year, 2000, around 2000, studying degeneresis loci of this kind of map between a fiber bundle. And then O'Grady was reconsidering this construction, so this is due to O'Grady, to consider these hypersurfaces. And when one uses this EPW sextic, one can construct double EPW sextic. So maybe I need a notation. Notation. So I will denote by yik the set of V in C6 such that the dimension of FV with A is bigger or equal than K. Okay, so this means clearly that yA is equal to yA of 1. Okay, so it's where a loci where the rank become smaller and smaller. And O'Grady was showing the following, that there is a double cover XA YA. So here we have an evolution which is in fact turns out to be non-symplectic, ramified, so we have two double cover this hypersurface in P5, that ramify on YA of 2, which is in fact in the singular locus of YA, and if A is not too bad, I will precise this, I don't know if I have time, maybe today, if A not too bad, let's say like this in this moment, but for now, then this YA2 is a surface, so this is in any case a surface. YA2 is a surface of general type and degree 40. And so we have here YA2. Here, up of this, we have a surface ZA contain XA, and the fixed locus, so by the construction, fixed locus of iota A on X is this surface ZA. So this was shown by O'Grady, but there is also a classification, a study of Beauville of non-symplectic involution on EHS manifold Otake I32, where he described this this fixed loci. So this is always a surface that not is always smooth, but does not need to be connected, for example, can have a more component. And this involution is non-symplectic. Okay, so if I have maybe 1 minute, let me formulate maybe the theorem of O'Grady. And then I'll show you tomorrow the connection with with the connection with Morin problem. So theorem of O'Grady. So take A a Lagrangian subspace, so in the variety LG lambda 3 C6 that parametrizes Lagrangian subspace of C6, and I take an open subset because this is equal to LG lambda 3 C6 minus two divisor. Let me just call sigma and delta. So I don't tell you today what are. And particularly sigma is the divisor that will play an important role when going to Morin. The other I will not talk about because it's not so important. And then we have that XA is smooth if and only if A is this space. So A is this space if and only if XA is smooth. So in this case, I am exactly in this situation. So the ramification is on this surface that is smooth, and I have nothing more singular. As soon as A go to this to divisor, then I put more singularities either on YA2 or outside, then XA become singular. It's smooth and called a double EPV sextic. So the name is clear. Why? Well, it's double. It's like a three double plane. And O'Grady and Ferretti show that XA is in fact the deformation equivalent to S2, where S is K3. And in fact, so first O'Grady showed that by finding an Hilbert scheme of this kind. But then come Ferretti and show that our XA with this involution iota is in fact deformation equivalent to the Bovill. With the Bovill involution are in the same deformation spaces. So that's another way to see that is holomorphism Plettig manifold of type K32. And well, maybe let me stop here because so then I will talk tomorrow about the sigma and the Morin problem. Okay.